first was founded in 1989 by Dean Kamen. As an inventor, he realizes that he can impact so many people with his inventions, but the way to have the biggest impact is to create a whole generation of new inventors. Through hands-on, engaging robotics challenges, FIRST ignites passion in STEM for kids ages 6 through 18. There's 4 worldwide programs where the kids dive deep into a problem and help invent a solution.
Once you get the challenge, you figure out your game plan.
You make a robot and you code on it.
When it works, I'm very happy because we worked really hard.
Throughout each of our programs, teams embrace FIRST core values.
Discovery.
Innovation.
Impact.
Inclusion.
Teamwork.
Fun.
At face value, FIRST is a robot competition. But at the end of the day, it's so much more than that.
We learn a lot about leadership, how to communicate with others, problem solving.
Working together, helping other teams.
You have mentors that are actually in the field that can tell you, oh, this is why this works, and this is the science behind it. And you're like, oh, wow, that makes so much sense.
Our mentors teach us not just about STEM, but about life.
They always flip the question around and ask me, where would you find the answer to that question if I weren't here? They slowly built my confidence up so much more.
I think it's incredibly important for youth to see careers in science and engineering as a possibility for them.
Being in FIRST, like, I realized I am smart enough to do this. It doesn't matter what background you come from.
FIRST actually taught me that I'm capable of doing anything that I set my mind to.
It definitely made me look at other challenges and be like, hey, I wanna try that.
I know that I can do it now.
There's nothing better than seeing your robot on the field playing for the first time. You're all there like, is it gonna work? Is it gonna work? And then when it works, it's the best feeling ever.
Even though we're competing against other teams, one thing that we really focus on is cooperation, which where every single team who we're competing against, we're also working together.
It's very competitive, but you're friends with the people that you're going against. It's like a sport, but in its own way, it's better than a sport.
I think FIRST in general really has helped me become more involved in my local community.
Back in my old elementary school, I'm trying to help their robotics program. If you start them off young, their possibilities are endless.
As a participant in the FIRST program in high school, you get access to $80 million worth of scholarships.
There are scholarships for colleges, universities, as well as technical programs.
FIRST really develops a pipeline where there's jobs, there's careers, there's opportunities for every one of these kids based on the skills and the experiences they develop in these programs.
In FIRST, every student can go pro. It's a really cool way to step into your future.
FIRST completely changed my life. It can really prepare you to solve any number of the world's big problems because they're going to teach you these applied skills around people, science, and how the two come together.
The future is technology, and I feel like robotics takes a big role, and I'm just really happy about being part of it.
I am FIRST.
Yo soy FIRST.
I am FIRST.
I am FIRST.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chris Osborne. I'm the program director for FIRST Indiana Robotics. And this is another one of our FIN virtual conferences. We're excited to be bringing you a lot of great content today. We're going to be, first off, watching a pre-recorded presentation from earlier in the week with Christina Harmon. She's going to talk to us about mindfulness. And definitely a good time to be talking about that topic, as a lot of us might be having higher levels of anxiety and other issues with being shelter in place, stay at home orders, things like that. That'll run for about a half hour. Then we have a really great interview we're excited about with Danielle Boyer, who hails from Michigan, Troy, Michigan, and she does a lot of things, including running a website called The Steam Connection. We're going to hear about all the great things she's up to up in Michigan and all over the United States. Then we'll have a panel conversation with the First Canada Youth Council and our own First Indiana Student Board of Directors, a little cultural collaboration to talk a little bit about what it's like to be in First in school in Canada and here in the United States. And then finally wrap up our conferences today. And we have a session on, yes, there is an I in team. Kathie Kentfield, who's been on before with us, is going to talk a little bit about tips for integrating introverts into your first team. So the first session that we're going to have, again, is a pre-recorded session with Christina Harmon on mindfulness. And I will get that going here momentarily.
Question about mindfulness is often, what is it? Webster defines mindfulness as a mental state achieved by focusing on one's awareness on the present moment, while calmly acknowledging and accepting one's feelings, thoughts, and bodily sensations. Mindfulness is just that. It's being present without judgment of yourself, experiencing the moment, activity, event as a whole body. Mindfulness is something that would be helpful to practice at all times, but especially during this entire time of stress and worry. The second question is often, what is mindfulness? Why is it important? Mindfulness is a tool to help you become calmer, more focused, and engaged in life. Mindfulness also is a coping skill. Many of our other healthy coping skills require the use of a specific activity or a tool that may not always be available to do anywhere, such as yoga, going for a walk, talking with a close friend, participating in hobbies, etc. With mindfulness, there is no limit on when to use this coping skill, how to do it, and where you can participate. When being mindful, we strive to be present, aware, non-judgmental of ourselves, our thoughts, our feelings, and our physical experience. To be non-judgmental, we look to the experience. We don't evaluate it. We identify if something's helpful or harmful, but not to pass an opinion, just to be aware. And we accept the moment without judging yourself, your experience, your thoughts, your feelings. The goal of mindfulness is to be present in life, to be able to walk away from rehashing our past experiences or imagining and worrying about the future. And at this point, many of us are doing just that. We're wondering and worrying about the future more than we're present in today. By doing this, we can lower our heart rate, we can slow our breathing, we can calm our central nervous system, and it releases the tensions in our muscles, all while returning to a positive engagement in the current present day, not worrying about everything else. Society is currently under a higher, longer lasting level of stress, fear, and worry than it's felt in day-to-day life. Stressful situations like this cause an adrenaline rush. This usually helps an individual to cope during the first moment or days following a crisis. But the thing that happens is our adrenaline usually returns to a much lower level. And as that happens, we begin to find a new normalcy, a new routine, and the crisis dissipates. This would cause the level of stress to decrease, and then again, the adrenaline continues to go down until we return to whatever new norm we have. Currently, with the pandemic that is happening, there is no way to fully adjust to a new normal. The normal continues to change on a regular basis. These changes include our jobs change, our governmental changes, our school changes, and just generally the understanding and impact of the pandemic changes from day to day. Due to this, we are currently experiencing more adrenaline rushes, which leads us to feel distress, exhaustion, and can then lead to generally feeling out of control. During this time, it's even more important to practice mindfulness. This will slow the adrenaline rush. It will help us to cope better with the higher levels of stress decreases the impact and sometimes even the occurrence of the adrenaline rushes in the first place. Thus, we gain the ability to concentrate, focus, and in general, we gain mental stability. The final question about mindfulness is generally, well, how can I be mindful? As you become mindful and aware, you become aware that the options are limitless in how you can practice being mindful. If you are breathing and present in a room, you can be mindful. But to start, we generally recommend practicing with things that require more concentration and focus, more in-depth steps, to help you to complete each one and feel as you're accomplishing this goal of mindfulness. I'm going to walk through three mindful activities together with you today that require these steps, some focus. And I'm going to give you information towards the end about others that you can do on your own and with a small group. I encourage you to follow along and try each of these activities as I walk through it, but also to pick one each day and practice it going forward. The first activity I'm going to tell you about is called the five senses. This particular mindfulness activity helps to slowly focus more on a final point than focusing on everything that's going on around us. We will use our senses to help us slow down and be more at peace. The goal is to focus on each step as we do it. You will be identifying things in your environment. We do this by using our natural senses to slowly refocus on ourselves. We will identify things that fit with each sense with a little detail. This helps us to focus on that object for a few seconds and pulls us again back to our environment we are in. The goal is not to simply state a window, a door, etc., but to describe it as though someone else could envision it. So an example may be a brown door with a silver handle, a glass window with a cream casing and a blue curtain. As we go through each sense is completed, I want you to take a deep breath in through your nose and out through your mouth, nice and slowly, so that you can move on to the next step. So now I'm going to prompt you through this activity. I'm going to pause, and I'm going to complete each activity stage in my own head, and I encourage you to say it out loud. Speak it to those around you, or if you're by yourself, saying it out loud so you can refocus yourself. At the end, I will prompt to take a breath, and then we will move on to the next one. The first thing we're going to focus on is we want to look at five things we can see. Again, we want to give a little bit of detail without going too in depth. So you can go ahead and start, and we'll take a breath at the end. As you complete, take a deep breath in through your nose and slowly blow it out through your mouth. We will now move on to four things that you can touch or feel. I want you to take the time to actually touch the objects. Like, I'm going to touch my shirt, I would touch my computer, as I'm describing what that feels like as I'm touching the object. You can begin, and we will again prompt to take a deep breath at the end. And take a deep breath. Now identify three things you can hear, again with a slight detail to be able to focus on it for a second. Take a deep breath. Now identify two things in your environment that you can smell, again with a slight definition and understanding of what they are. Take a deep breath in through the nose and out through the mouth. And finally, you're going to try to take one thing that you can taste in your mouth currently. Identify it. Take a deep breath through your nose and out through your mouth. Take that deep breath. That is the first and easiest activity to use. It can be done anywhere at any time. You need nothing special to complete this. This is a great tool to use when you're going into something you know will be stressful, such as a presentation, a meeting, a test, or anything else that you know you're going to walk into a situation and immediately feel stressed because of what is happening. The second activity we will be doing together, the second and third both are palm exercises. So the first one we're going to do is going to focus on your breathing. I don't know about you guys, but I do struggle when people tell me to concentrate on my breathing because I feel like I sometimes then have more trouble breathing. So I have found that when doing mindfulness activities, it's better to focus on something else while focusing on your breathing. So you're going to take the palm of your hand. You're going to hold it up. I want you to pay attention to everything that happens on your palm while also paying attention to your breathing. Don't judge any thought that may pop into your head. Gently refocus on the activity you are completing. Don't worry if you get distracted. Just come back to what you're doing. You're going to lift your other hand. You take your index finger and make a pointer. And you're going to start at the base of your thumb. And you're just going to slowly slide your finger up your thumb and then down and up and down. And you're going to do this all the way around your hand. As you go up a finger, you're going to breathe in. As you go down, you're going to breathe out. You're going to go in through your nose and out through your mouth. The goal is not to race and get breath quickly. The goal is to take slow, deep breaths. So we're going to begin. As we get all the way over, we're going to then come back. And we're going to do the exact same thing coming back. You're going to take slow breaths up. And let it out slowly. And you're going to come all the way back until you get back to yourself. I'm going to do this with you, and then I will pause for a few seconds afterwards to let you finish if you have not caught up with me. And then we will move on to the next activity. So we're going to put your palm up, spread those fingers so you can get between them. Take your index finger and start here. And breathe in. As you sit and do that activity now, think on what you felt while you were doing it. Oftentimes it's described to me that you can feel a tickling or a tingling sensation as you're going up and down your hand. This helps us to have a sensory connection with ourselves, which then again helps us to slow those adrenaline rushes. It causes us to be more focused. And you're paying attention to that, so you're not paying attention to everything else. Again, slowing our adrenaline rush and making us more focused. So that was the second one. You did one hand. Now I want you to do the third one on your other hand. This is called finger palm mindfulness. To do this, you're going to hold your hand up and you're going to take your index finger again. You want to use the opposite hand because you already kind of triggered your senses and your nerves in your one hand. So now we want to be able to feel it in the other. So we want to use the other hand. Take your index finger. You're going to put it on the palm of your hand. It really doesn't matter where. Just make it in the palm of your hand. After you do that, you're going to simply start moving your finger around your palm. As you do this, I want you to notice the sensation. I want you to feel the tingle, the tickle, and I want you to notice your breathing. We're not going to worry about other things. If a thought pops in our head, we want to say, I see you and goodbye, and come back to paying attention to the sensations on your hand. We're going to pause and do this for 1 to 2 minutes. And at the end, we will take a deep breath. Continue those slow, deep breaths as we do this exercise. Hold your hand up, take your other pointer, and start. The great thing about this exercise is you can do it until your hand stops tingling and responding. If you still do not feel calm, you raise the other hand and you move on to the other. And you begin to do the same thing. Feel your finger, trace it, keep going. This is a great exercise because you can bounce back and forth between hands. As soon as one hand has had a break for a minute, it will start to respond again. Again, sometimes we're in situations where we need to be longer mindful, or we need to be more focused. This is also a great exercise because I can put my hands below my desk. I can put my hands on the desk. I can hide my hands in all kinds of ways, and no one would ever know that I would be doing a mindfulness activity, especially in those meetings, those classrooms, those times that we're anxious. No one has to know that you're doing this activity, or even recognize it, which is a great skill to have available to you when you're in your professional and in personal life. Doing these three types of activities every day at least one time will lower your stress level. It's going to increase your ability to remain focused and positively affect your overall mental health. In this time of stress, in this time of news constantly being thrown at us and bombarded, and the constant changes that are happening in our world, it is really important that we do anything and everything we can to stabilize our mental health, to give us a chance to deal with these changes as positively as possible. These activities take such a short amount of time that we all could find time to do them in our day. I'm now going to give you three other activities that you can complete. I'm going to walk through how to do them. We will not do them together because they take a little bit of different time and different thoughts. One is very quick, another is longer, and then another is a more advanced mindfulness. As I go through these, they will be available for you with directions. I will include directions for the three mindfulness activities we have already done, for these three mindfulness activities, and I am going to provide some links to a couple other great websites that have mindfulness activities, all of which you can access after this. The other easy, great mindfulness activity that I love, and I think we all should use it every time we turn around all day long, it's called the yawn and stretch. Sounds simple, sounds easy, but every hour during the day, if we just take 10 seconds and stretch our arms, moving around slightly, it doesn't have to be anything crazy, and have a good yawn while you're doing it, your body will start to relax. The goal for you is to pay attention to the feelings in your body, to pay attention to your breathing during that time, to, again, not be judgmental and not be focused on ourselves, all of which will help you to relax. This mindfulness activity has been recommended time and time again in therapy sessions and in presentations I have sat in, to do it every day, every hour or two. It is a quick, easy, fast mindfulness way to get recentered. The second activity that I enjoy describing and I enjoy having people do is called a category name everything activity. The great thing about this activity is it's one of the few mindfulness activities that actively require you and somebody else to do it. You can do it by yourself, but especially in small groups or families or in a situation that you and somebody else may be sitting waiting on something, it is a great activity just to kind of get your mind resettled and refocused. The other thing about this particular activity is when we do it with somebody else, we all have our natural competitive sides to help us to engage in a longer period of mindfulness. To do this category name everything activity, all you need to do is simply pick a category. I have had people do movie titles, restaurants, food types, fruits and vegetables, animals at the zoo, or animals of any kind. There is absolutely no wrong answer as to what your category is. You simply name the category, make sure you and somebody else, if you're doing it with somebody else, if it's you alone, that you have plenty of ideas. We wouldn't want to say name the colors of the rainbow. That would not be a very long activity. We want to make it something that we can be more in depth with. So again, animals at the zoo, you can go on for quite a while. This activity can take up to however long you want. I've done this with people and it's taken 10, 15 minutes before they've ran out of activity, or excuse me, ran out of items that fit into that category. That has helped them to be completely relaxed and calm. All you're going to do is you're going to name something, the other person's going to name something, then you're going to name something, the other person's going to name something, and you keep going in that way until one of you can't name another item. That person then becomes not the winner, and the other person is the winner. Again, we're not really focused on who's going to win or who's going to not. It's really something that just requires you to stop and think. If we have other thoughts that come into our head during this activity, push them aside. Don't stress about finding another thing. It's just fun. Have fun with it, be present, and you will find that you are able to relax in the end and feel much calmer. This is a great activity for families, especially. I have done this with my own family. We have done this on road trips when everybody is getting unsettled in the car. Anytime we have a long wait for something, I have done this. I've done this with families at hospitals, you name it, you can do it anywhere. And it really helps to calm your senses and be present. The last activity that I'm going to share with you is called the cloud or river exercise. This one takes some more advanced mindfulness because you really have to focus and visualize. But as you work through the other activities, you can get to the place where you can do this and really have some success with it. I want you to take a second and notice a thought or a feeling associated with that thought. So you might notice the thought and then have the feeling associated with it. So it could be, I have a test today and I'm really scared. You take those two thoughts and feelings and you place them on a log. You know, close your eyes as you do this. You know, place it on the log in your head. And I'm putting down my thought of I have a stress and my feeling, or excuse me, that I have a test and my feeling that I have stress about it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to place that log in the river, or I'm going to put it on a cloud and I'm going to watch them both float away. Either way is fine. It doesn't matter what's right and wrong. You can put it on a boat. It does not matter. Put it on something and watch it float away from you, so that you no longer hold on to those thoughts and feelings. The goal of that is that you will be calmer because you've gotten rid of the stressor. There are many other mindful meditations on YouTube and simple Google searches regarding mindful activities provide you with multiple reputable websites that have other various mindful activities. As you practice, you will find that mindfulness activities are limitless, and you will be able to find more and more things that are helpful and are able to help you refocus.
Well, Christina, we want to thank you for sharing those activities with us, the mindfulness activities. I put a link in the Twitch chat to the PDF that has a description of all those activities that Christina went over with us today. That's something that you could even do with your team at a competition or at team meetings, just to take some time to be a little more mindful. So again, thank you. I want to throw in real quick a bit of an ad for the National Advocacy Conference. Each year, the National Advocacy Conference takes place in Washington, D.C. This year, it is, like most everything else, going virtual. It's going to be two Saturdays, June 13th and June 20th. They're half-day sessions. And so here you can attend one or both. You can learn how to engage with your elected officials. And really, they're going to focus this year on a lot of advocacy 101 training. There's no cost to attend, but they do ask that you register for the sessions ahead of time. All are welcome, but this program really is geared more towards FRC and FTC participants. And again, you can learn more and you can register at firstnac.org. Again, this year it's going to be virtual and it's going to be focused on Advocacy 101. Definitely look forward to those sessions and we'll have, I'll have a link to that in the Twitch chat here in a bit. And of course, also on our website, firstindianarobotics.org. And now, next up, I would like to bring on Priya. And Priya, you're going to introduce our next guest. I'm going to, there we go. I'm going to take off and let you go from here.
All right. Thanks, Chris. Make sure you guys check out the Virtual National Advocacy Conference. It's a really good way to get involved with your legislation. And I know myself and the other board members have been really making a lot of progress this year with the Indiana legislation and FRC Robotics. So definitely check it out if you have time. Now I'll be introducing our guest, Danielle Boyer, and she is an educator, an author, an inventor, entrepreneur, so many things. I'll let her tell you guys more about her, but Chris will be playing like a quick slideshow of pictures of her and stuff. So we'll just get started with questions. So my first question for you, Danielle, is when and how did you get started with like robotics and like teaching? How did you kind of figure out your passions?
First of all, thank you so much for having me. I absolutely love you guys, and it's a huge honor. I actually got started in STEAM education, so science, tech, engineering, art, and math, when I was 10 years old. So I was homeschooled up until the middle of my sophomore year of high school, which is a really long time. And I noticed that kids like my little sister were interested in STEAM learning, but we didn't have a lot of those types of opportunities. So I started out with an animal science class and went on to teach a bunch of more classes just at 10 years old. I put together curriculum, I made coloring sheets, I did everything. And then the year after, I actually started a RoboFest team for my little sister. RoboFest is through Lawrence Tech in Michigan. It's a lot like Vexer First. It's a smaller robotics competition type thing, often with Lego Mindstorms. And I didn't do anything with it for a while, like robotics through homeschooling. There, as I said, there weren't a lot of opportunities, especially for kids my own age. So I waited until high school and then I joined a FIRST robotics team and then later joined Benzene Bots, which is the team that I'm alumni from. So FIRST robotics competition team. And they're from International Academy East.
All right, that's amazing. So what are like your favorite memories or parts of FIRST that kind of like you remember by as like an alum or mentor that you keep looking forward to?
So for good memories, I mean, I absolutely love just hanging out with everyone and learning. It is so cool to be in an environment where you feel safe, kind of failing forward and constantly learning. Whether like one time I wrote on our team shirts, I spelled Michigan incorrectly, and it's a running just joke on the team. And even though it's super embarrassing, it's such a good memory, to be honest, just because of how funny it is. And they're my family, to be honest, like Benzene Bots and all the kids I work with, they really are my family. Like the president this year, Dakshish, I actually got to bring him to Dallas last year for SolidWorks World, and I got to bring him to 3D Experience World, as you guys can see on the screen. He's in the picture, actually. I brought him to 3D Experience World 2020 in Nashville this year, too. So we're just a huge family, and that's what I look forward to every season and every year, is just seeing my family more and continuing to learn more about STEAM.
Yeah, absolutely. So what is like your biggest takeaways from your experiences in FIRST or like robotics mentoring and all of that?
Well, it's helped me. This is a very weird answer, I think, but it's helped me a lot with my branding and documentation skills. Like I make worksheets and stuff for the teams that I work with, whether it's for what they should do for their special project in FLL, or whether it be, you know, presentation practice and stuff like that, or booklets from the teams that I work with. I mentor and assist 35 teams, including VEX. So mentoring that many teams has really helped me come up with a system to better help more and more teams and to provide resources that they're going to benefit from. So I would say that's one of my biggest takeaways, is just learning, okay, this is actually helpful, this isn't helpful. I've learned that doing inspection days for my FTC teams has been really helpful for them. I've learned that creating booklets with my FIRST robotics competition teams, like for the judges and stuff, has been really, really helpful. So yeah, it's just learning what works best and then being able to execute it. And I've even been able to do that in my own life. And it actually helped me self-publish 5 children's books. So learning layout, documentation, writing, all that stuff, it has been really beneficial. And then on the robotics end, it got me more and more interested. I've been interested in STEM, STEAM for a really long time. Like I want to be a robotics researcher, but FIRST kind of solidified that and made me realize that robotics is the thing for me, and that it can be for girls too, which is often something I thought it didn't affect me, like thinking that girls couldn't be in STEAM, but it did to an extent. And then being in FIRST more and more and being one of the only girls on a team, it actually made me realize, oh wow, I can actually do this and I can continue to help others through it.
Yeah. So you mentioned like you have like a lot of teams that you directly mentor and a lot of other side projects, but can you tell me a little bit more about the lecturing you've done for FIRST?
The lecturing, yeah. So at the FIRST Detroit World Championship, I've lectured twice. It's actually the longest lecturing I've ever done in my entire life. Right off the bat, I hadn't done a lot of public speaking. Right off the bat, I'm like, I'm going to do a 2-hour lecture on FTC branding. So I actually did that, which it was live streamed and everything, which is slightly terrifying. But I learned a lot from it and now get to do really cool speaking engagements. Like I got to speak in front of thousands of people at 3D Experience World, which you guys can see on the screen, which was really awesome. They own SolidWorks, which sponsors FIRST. And Dean Kamen was there too. So it was really cool. It almost felt like everything had come full circle because I just love him so much. And to be able to meet him again and, you know, even speak alongside him was so cool. But I feel like lecturing and everything like that is a really good opportunity for people to see women in STEAM and STEM talking about their experience firsthand. And my favorite part is answering all the questions that people have.
Yeah, absolutely. And speaking of questions, there's a question from Twitch. Okay. How are you still keeping busy during this uncertain time?
It's definitely difficult. I'm very extroverted, so it's hard to sometimes stay to keep working. I've been setting up a podcast called Bots with Boyer that I'm going to be starting soon. And I've been pre-recording episodes, and I've just been working through like the RSS feed and all of that stuff. I have been working on a project where I'm inventing a sensor. I'm working on a Dalek robot for Halloween. I'm working on a car couch. So I'm doing a lot of different things. It definitely can be hard to stay motivated, but I think it's important to
Yeah, and that's like the big project, right? Can you tell us about your Every Kid Gets a Robot project? And yes, you said you had a robot to show us too.
Yeah, I do. So this is Every Kid Gets a Robot. So this is a little guy right here. It's 3D printed, and here I'll show just a chassis. You guys, it's so bright right here. So this is Every Kid Gets a Robot. It's a robot that costs less than $20 and goes to kids for free. I actually just partnered with Dassault Systems, so the company who owns SolidWorks, and we donated 50% of which went to indigenous organizations. I'm indigenous, so it just meant a lot to be able to do that. A lot of robotics kits, you're not able to do all of those things, and often it'll cost like $400, $500, especially for like educational kits and stuff like that. And I was like, some really cool things with it and reached thousands of kids. So it's really cool.
That's amazing. So what are your like plans going forward with that project then? Like
with this project?
So like in the recent times, what are you like planning right now?
Well, I was going to do a Native American Outreach Day with the Rochester Institute of Tech. Unfortunately, that's had to been postponed because of the pandemic. But I'm looking to start an online class with the robots where I can ship them out individually and I can still connect with kids even though I can't see them physically. I want to continue to bring the robots to thousands and thousands of more kids. And I'm even working on another robot design so that I can continue to engage the kids with new and updated content.
Yeah, absolutely. So you kind of brushed on it a little bit, but when you're talking about like having virtual classes and kind of changing things up, what is your podcast going to be like? You said you were pre-recording episodes.
Yeah, so I really want to focus on interviewing women, especially who are in robotics and who are in STEM, because I was thinking like, what would I listen to? And I really want to hear other people who are forging a path for women like me in STEAM and STEM. I think that would be super, super cool. And I also want to hear from different types of engineers. I want to tell some stories about what I do because I have going on. Like I'm updating my children's books right now to hopefully get an actual publisher instead of just self-publishing them. And I'm also working on a memoir. So I want to be able to talk through those processes and kind of hopefully encourage people to pursue a career in STEAM.
Yeah. So you mentioned your work for women in robotics.
My reservation is in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. I'm about 10 hours down below near Detroit. And I frequently work with an organization called ACES. So ACES stands for American Indian Science and Engineering Society. And they do amazing, amazing, amazing work for Indigenous people in STEM. And I first got into joining and I got to do something called the Boeing STEM Day with ACES and Boeing, where we assembled robots, got to see cool 3D prints that I brought, and were able to engage high school and middle school students in STEM learning, especially through the robots. And then the day after I did a lecture, and I actually also did my first scientific poster that I had ever done, which is completely terrifying because it's like, how do you even do that? And I wasn't doing it like through school or anything like that. I was just doing it on my own and opportunity because I got to open up the floor to everyone else to kind of see what we can do to benefit each other as Indigenous leaders and what we can do, like whether it be an online chat or whether it be a website, whether it be continuing to support each other through ACES, like what we can do. So it is really cool and really honoring to be a part of that.
Yeah, it's so amazing that you're able to impact so many different types of communities. I find that really inspiring.
Thank you. The pictures that I gave you, most of them are me at their conferences. So they have a conference. It used to be called SolidWorks World, and now it's called 3D Experience World. And it is one of the coolest conferences ever. They have the 3D Experience platform. They have SolidWorks, their software. They have a lot of different opportunities for students, especially. One of my favorite products of theirs is the SolidWorks app for kids. And I actually have my students' prints right here. My students look how cute they are. My students designed these in the SolidWorks app for kids and they're little robots, right? Obviously they don't work, but the challenge was, what do you think a robot should look like or does look like already? And they designed these in the app for kids. And then I was able to print it on a printer that SolidWorks donated for me. So they really support my pursuits in promoting STEAM education for children. Like, they really helped with my engineering design club last summer. And in turn, Irene, it's so cute. This is, it's just a robot. I don't know what type, but this is by Jaesung. And then this is a little bunny. So the kids love the little ones. And I did the Detroit Maker Faire for the first time last year. And I had like a booth. They told me I was doing a booth like the day before, but I did a booth and I was able to print out big versions of the kids' prints to kind of show what we've been doing in the app for kids and what we've been doing in SolidWorks, which was really cool. And I have these little guys too. So cute. And I designed this little guy in the app for kids. So yeah, I absolutely love their products. I'm honored that I'm able to teach with them and I'm able to share what I'm doing. I've been on their podcast. I was on their main stage. I've done a lot of different stuff with them. And of course, they're the ones who supported sending 150 robots to kids for free, which is amazing. And I said 50% of which were for free to Indigenous organizations. They paid for the shipping, they paid for everything. And they're the reason why all 150 of these kids are going to be able to utilize STEM resources. So really awesome of them.
Yeah, that sounds great. Well, where do you want to kind of head forward with your career? Mm-hmm. And like you're a freshman at, tell us about like your major and.
So I'm double majoring in mechanical engineering and electrical engineering with a minor in physics, which is not as easy as moving out of state soon and pursuing like an education at Washington State University, even for undergrad, because I know I'm going to be here a while, so might as well be at a school where I really like, but I'm at Wayne right now to help with my sister and stuff like that. She's immunocompromised, and so I help her, but I really want to pursue a career in biorobotics, and I also want to pursue a career in de-droning, so drone security and safety. So those are the kind of the things I'm interested in. It's probably for a future career. So research is definitely where I believe I'm headed. And I always want to continue to work in nonprofit work because that's just so cool. The road, and its name is Otto Oscar, like Oscar the Grouch. And I absolutely love that. It is so cool to see that I'm inspiring the kids to pursue their love for STEM and STEAM. And it's just crazy. I let the kids do almost anything. I let them use my 3D printer. I let them use my soldering irons, everything like that. And it's really cool to be able to teach them how to utilize technical skills to pursue their ideal future. So it's definitely knowing I was being made fun of before I even heard anything. And it made me want to stop pursuing STEAM. It really did. It was so discouraging. And it was the worst feeling ever, especially because a lot of it was pretty severe, having to involve police and everything. Like it was a really difficult time. And I constantly was like, I don't know if I should be doing this. I don't know if I should just quit and kind of move on and not do this anymore. But I joined Benzene Bots. It was discouraging, especially having been homeschooled and it's like your first full year at public school. And just to have that reaction, especially there weren't a lot of girls on the team and stuff. And it was just really difficult. And I'm really glad that I was able to overcome that and continue doing what I am now. But that was such a hard time. And unfortunately, I know a lot of kids go through that. So I really respect the mentors and stuff who go out of their way to make sure that kids feel safe. And, you know, all the volunteers and everything who, if they see something happening, they're able to stop it. Like, that's what needs to happen. And I really, really respect those people who are doing that. And it's actually mentors who help me find my place in STEM and help me get out of the situation that I was in. And because of that, I continue to love FIRST.
Yeah, I definitely see how that could be really hard.
Yeah.
Especially like, and that kind of falls into line with your work too, with like women in STEM and such. But yeah. So how, like moving from like, homeschool to public school to like as an alum and mentor, how have your experiences kind of changed in robotics and teaching?
Go along with a drivable car couch. I think that's hilarious. And I think robotics and tech should be really fun. And so you see characters who look like them doing really amazing things in STEAM. And just to see kids, like I brought some of the pages to the Maker Faire and I actually showed some of the kids. And even to see kids, see characters who look nothing like them say, oh my gosh, you're so beautiful. That's like the love I want to inspire. And so I was at the first Detroit World Championship last year, and I brought my all girls robotics team back because I tried doing 19 credits while doing that. And that was, let's just say, impossible. It was very, very hard. I slept like 2 hours a day at that point. I was like, you know what?
What have you been able to learn through this pandemic situation?
Well, it's hard because there's a large fear aspect to it. Everyone's rather uncertain. So that has been really cool to be able to connect with people who you might not normally connect with. But I like going outside, so it's a little hard. I'm lucky though, I have an office, as you guys can see right here, where I have a conference room. Ooh, it's getting bright again. You can just see me turn into a ghost, actually. I have a ghost 3D print right here, and you can barely tell any difference. But I'm able to work on my robot kits and everything here, which is really great. And a lot of people don't have that opportunity. But yeah, it's definitely weird seeing everyone just on Zoom calls and seeing everyone online. It's kind of surreal. Most of my friends, though, are already like in different states and stuff, like especially through like STEM and stuff. So I'm used to that, but I'm definitely not used to the level of this, nor is anyone else.
Today, thank you so much for coming and spending your time here. And we are so happy to have you on the stream.
Thank you so much for having me, even though I look like a complete ghost. I really appreciate it. And I appreciate what you guys are doing, especially during the pandemic for, you know, people who are stuck at home and who aren't able to
link out there, and several of the other things that you had brought up during the conversation. We'll try to get those on our website for our remote resources. Stay safe, stay healthy. We look forward to seeing all the amazing things that you're doing up there and all over. Again, thank you so much. And Priya, thank you for your time interviewing Danielle. It was a great conversation. And now we're going to move on to a break for about 15 minutes. We're going to come back at 5:30 with a conversation between our First Indiana Robotics Student Council and some members of the First Canada Youth Council. So I look forward to that conversation to learn more a little bit about some cultural collaboration. So we'll be back in about 15 or 16 minutes. In the meantime, we've got a slideshow of pictures of robots from all over the state of Indiana. All right. great content. We've got a couple of really great interviews tomorrow. We've got Nick Lawrence from Annie Mark, who's also a mentor. They're going to talk. He's going to be talking about resource tokens and how to build within your means. We're going to have a get to know your 2020 student
interaction can happen where we live in totally different parts of North America, but we're still bonded through this shared organization. We get to have chats like this. That's my favorite part of Web First.
So hi, my name's Emily. I'm from Stony Creek, Ontario. I'm on Team 2056, and I do mechanical and wiring and assembly and some outreach on my team.
Hi, I'm Karen. I'm on Team 7617 in Carmel, Indiana. I'm a co-captain, so I do a little bit of everything. Our team is pretty small because University High School is a really small private school with about 300 kids, so all of us do a little bit of everything.
Hi, my name is Addie. I'm on Team FRC Team 6956 in Westfield, Indiana, and I lead the programming and website teams. And something I love about FIRST is like the really big family, the family community that it fosters, because I like to see how everyone bonds together through STEM and through outreach.
Hi, my name is Nahak. I'm on Team 4939. I mainly do mechanical and outreach and strategy on my team. I think my favorite part about FIRST is like the family and how many connections you're able to build. So I'm really excited and looking forward to all the things that we can talk about now.
Hi, my name is Ishan and I'm from Team 2706 Merge Robotics. I'm from Ottawa, Ontario, so the capital of Canada. And the thing I love about FIRST is sort of similar to Addy, where you know, you get to connect with different people and sort of join that passion for STEM.
Hi, my name is Huda. I'm from Team 1241 in Mississauga, Ontario, and I mainly do mechanical and outreach on our team as well. One thing I really love about FIRST is the community, like someone mentioned before, the community that we build around here, like being able to connect and make connections like these.
I'm Peyton. I'm from Bloomington, Indiana on Team 3494. I do outreach, awards, business, and manufacturing and assembly on my team. And a thing I really like about FIRST is the life experience you gain that you can take into college and then your career later on.
All right. So now that we know everyone, we'll get into our questions. So today we'll be talking about kind of like school life and academics, and then kind of robotics, and then we'll just kind of leave it open-ended to whatever Twitch questions we get or whatever we end up discussing. So for these questions, anyone can pop in and just answer. We can kind of see everyone on the screen here so we know when people are gonna start talking. So the first one is what?
So for myself, I go to a public school and it's sort of the same sort of style. We have public schools, private school. We have a bunch of different.
Yeah. So I go to an independent school, which is similar to a private school. The difference is in Toronto, actually Ontario, we have this independent school system. So what makes a private school independent is they're part of this independent, what's called.
I guess our next thing is, and some of you kind of mentioned it too with course options, what are your guys' options for like what kind of classes you can take? Can you like, because a really popular thing in the US and Indiana is that you can like accelerate, especially in math and English, you can take higher level if you test into it. And like just whatever electives, like I know like I had to take an arts class, so I took film this year. So just like, what kinds of options does everyone have at their school?
Could you explain the test into it part? Because I don't think we quite have that, at least in the public school system here.
So usually for actually all schools, I think for us in sixth grade, for me, it was a little bit earlier just because of how our school worked. But we took a test in sixth grade, I think like an IQ test or something. And then you get placed into either for math and English. For math, you can go 3 grades ahead, 2 grades ahead, 1 grade ahead, and normal. Then for English, it's 2 grades ahead and 1 grade ahead. And then there's also like advanced placement and international baccalaureate, yeah. Which I think are.
Yeah, we have We have AP and IB too. That's really interesting, that first process. I'm not sure if any of the other Canadians.
To advance. Mm-hmm.
At my school. Sorry,
it's okay.
At my school, we also accelerate. So, but instead of testing into it, we kind of just assume everybody's able to go 1 year ahead. And then if you're not, for whatever reason, or if you're new, so you came in, like if you came in at grade 10 and everyone else is doing grade 11 math, you can't just skip a grade. Then we have classes for people who are at grade level. But the majority of kids at my school are a year or 2 years ahead in math.
Mm-hmm. Maybe Mahak, you could talk about AP, right? Because I think your school offers that.
Yeah, so my school does AP. And I think, yeah, so you have to test into it. And usually the tests are in grade 8. And there's also like different regional programs. So there's like pre-IB, which is in grade 6 and 6, 7, and 8. And then I think there's also like, we have EQAO in Ontario, which is a way that they assess like your math and English skills. And based on, I think for certain schools, based on your test scores in those like exams, you can get placed into like gifted programs, which I think would be similar to what you said about like advancing like a grade level higher, depending on like where you are.
Mm-hmm. I think generally with a number of our schools is that we have streams. So you can go into, I guess, academic, which is more like general or the standard. And then you can go into more advanced classes or applied if you need a bit more help. For me, I have the IB program, and my IB program started in grade 9 with pretty cool choices in grade 9 and 10. I know that a lot of schools have, say, woodworking. I did an auto shop when I was in grade 9, which was a lot of fun. And something else that's mandatory for the Ontario diploma is that everyone has to take a gym credit in grade 9. Usually people take it, but it's just to graduate. We also have to have a Canadian history credit, but you can take those in summer school, or you can do it in grade 9 instead of grade 10 if you'd like. And I think we also have a civics and careers credit, which is a course that has to do with the government. So that's the civics part. And then careers is job opportunities and college and university and all that.
A bunch of school, I know a bunch of robotic schools that have robotics teams also have a course robotics. So my school has one for grades 11 to grade 12, and we sort of either work on the robot during robotics season, or we learn more about the game, or do some, like my school does grade 8 days or gifted days, and we prep for things like that.
There's also something called like Explore High Skills. In different like high schools, so you'll have like different specialist programs where like the high school specializes in providing those courses. For example, like my school is like the technology and hospitality. So my school would provide a lot of technology courses which are not available in other high schools. And sometimes like manufacturing courses or like robotics courses, like Emily said, those won't be provided in other schools where like you have art programs or something like that. So that's also something different from each high school.
Yeah, what's also interesting is that, sorry, my school has like a sports program and business programs for special high school majors. So I think it's like interesting that there's like different like courses, like a leadership course offered, which is mainly based around like sports, and then also like basically community work. So I know a few people in my
classes and tests, and there's standardized tests like for advanced placement, IB. And then we also have this thing called the SAT and ACT and college admissions. So I was wondering, like, is there like a hardest year in Canada, or like a year where like there's the most homework or whatever?
So I think the last year, because you have to shove a lot in your first semester, a lot of the harder course in your first semester when you're applying for second semester, from what I hear last year. But anyone else got any other opinions?
I think it also partly depends on the school. I know a lot of students will take, like, yeah. I have to take a lot of really scary courses in grade 11, but I know some of my friends who are actually taking AP exams or SATs or ACTs to apply to American schools will take those advanced courses in grade 11, or they'll start in grade 10. So it depends on the person too.
I think most like what Ontario schools can say is that the transition from grade 10 to grade 11 is like the hardest, because in grade 10, like grade 9, you're kind of like chilling. The teachers don't pile a lot of homework. If you don't do homework, you can just like, you know.
Story courses. And at least for my school, careers and civics and careers are very not super demanding courses. But then once you get to grade 11 and 12, you start choosing, and now you're depending on what route you're taking in terms of your electives, you might be getting into some difficult territory. Unless you're in a mirror and you don't get electives.
I think some people, I know for sure IB students usually take those electives earlier on. And so I'm not sure if this is the same for IB schools in the States as well, but we're only allowed to take two sciences in IB. So I took a third science in grade 10 and then the summer after grade 10 to complete the grade 11 and grade 12 courses for that. So I know a lot of students will sort of fast track in that sense, get all three sciences, but that's just for the IB program, I think.
I don't know if this is a thing in Canada, but I go to like a college prep school. So like from day one, like the whole goal is to get you ready for college. So like we start our resumes day two of freshman year, and then you meet with your college counselor like all throughout sophomore and junior year to plan your courses. And we also all get faculty mentors. So like I have a mentor that I meet with every 2 weeks, and your mentor basically like helps you pick your classes and also like with your college application process. So for us, like for me, I got to start choosing electives and classes sophomore year, but for a majority of our students, a lot of kids start doing that like junior and senior year, where you basically get a ton of freedom to choose whatever classes you want to rigor, and there's still a lot of choice for us.
I actually wasn't going to mention this, but I just remembered, I think we should mention our class sizes, like how many people are in your grade, because I think you'll be surprised by some of the numbers. So whoever can start.
Like how many people should start? In our grade, like in our school or in like a class? Like
in your school, like how many people are in 11th grade or whatever?
Okay, I can start. I think there are 84 kids in my grade.
Go ahead.
No, okay. You can go, Ishan.
Oh yeah. So for me, I have about 400 people in each grade. In my grade, yeah.
I have 200 in each in grade 11 at least. It gets more each year. I know that.
That's the same number as Ishan. Like about, so for the grade freshmen, like the most this year, I believe there were like 450 freshmen. But each as like grade 12 is like it's like cutting down as you go. So grade 12 is like about 300. Grade until grade 11 is like a pretty consistent number, 400 students in each grade. And then grade 12, like people suddenly start like dropping out. Because it gets too hard.
I think so for us, we have about,
sorry.
How do you go?
No. I was going to say there's around, I think 100 people in like the advanced placement program at my school, but I think 300 per grade in total. My school's actually pretty small for like compared to ones around the limit area.
Peyton, how about yours? Sorry, I interrupted you there.
Oh, no, it's fine. My graduating class that I'll be in is about 400, but our freshman class this year was our biggest, and I think it had 600, maybe a little more.
Wow. I think we have about 25 or 40 kids in our IB class, and then in terms of all the kids in our grade, we have about 250.
So like at our school, it's anywhere between 60 to 90 kids. Typically the freshman class is a little bit smaller, but senior class is usually larger. I think we're about like 85-ish, so about the same as Emiko.
For Westfield, we have about 580-ish, maybe a little bit more for my class, my junior class. And then for our largest class, our sophomores, is like around 600. So,
oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Maybe Devin and then Priya go.
Well, I mean, it's just me being homeschooled. I mean, we were supposed to have like a little like graduation type thing for like the homeschoolers in my community, but that's not going to happen because of COVID. So, and I was going to be like, maybe like 10, maybe, but.
Grand finale, Priya.
Okay, so our school is a little well known in Indiana for being a little big. Our graduating class this year is 1,500 people, and our high school has like 5,500 people.
Oh my gosh.
How big is your school?
It's been compared to like some undergraduate college campuses. It's like in our like city downtown too, and it's really like it's a big place.
I can't even think of one in Ontario that has 5,500 kids. The most I've heard, I think, is about 2,500, and they had to move all the kids to another school.
Well, that's a thing too, because in some of the neighboring cities have like once they reach like max capacity, they split and build another school. But the problem, what happened with mine is like, well, it is like very crowded, but like there's a rule that every kid in that area have to have the same opportunities. So like, if they were to build another one of my schools, it would be too expensive for them. So they can't, they just have to keep getting more people.
And oh my God. Would you say the population in your school is growing every year, or has it been pretty consistently massive?
I think it's been like about 5,000 for like 2005 to 2015 or so. And then about like 2015 to 2020, about like 5,400. But right now, like schools are like, oh, like you guys can go somewhere else now.
That's crazy. Yeah. Do all schools, or do the majority of American schools, offer the AP programs or AP courses?
If they can afford to, like if their teachers are trained.
Because I know that at least in the board that I used to be in, there were catchment areas for a specific program. So let's say if you got into the AP program or if you got into the IB program, then they would send you to a school that was in your catchment area. So it depends on where you live as well. And I know that some people would buy properties in other areas to go to different schools and stuff like that.
Well, that's kind of a case for my school. A lot of people move to my city to go to my school. So, and I don't know, Addie, do you take PLTW classes?
No.
But do you know?
Yeah, we do have a few of those. I think the ones that I do know of are the engineering and the biomedical ones. We also offer like some other classes like through a local community college for like culinary arts or for like auto shop people. But another thing about our school is that we don't really have an AP like group, but you can take them like whenever. So like from like freshman to senior, they're available should you have the qualifications to get to that class?
Yeah. We got a little bit derailed, but how do college admissions work where you live? Because process, I think, is a little bit different.
Ishan, do you want to talk about that? You're the only one in grade 12.
Actually, I am in grade 11.
Grade 11.
Hey, wait, you? Oh, shoot.
Ishan's very tall.
Does anyone know specifically? We're all in grade 11, and you apply for colleges in grade 12?
Yeah. So the way it works, in like at least in my school, is that you would have, in late fall, you would have like the university fairs and college fairs and everything. People would come to your school, and then they open up this OUAC website, which is like the Ontario University or like something applications website. And like you would make your applications in there, and you'd send to different universities and colleges. And then like, depending on whether you're getting early acceptance or like normal acceptance, like you would get it in February or like March or like late April, your acceptance would start rolling in. That's like the most of it I know, but next year we could answer that question probably more in detail.
Yeah. I just want to flex Karen right now, but Karen, can you, she's going to MIT, if you guys know. It's like a
congratulations, Karen. That's amazing.
That's so cool.
That's amazing.
That's amazing.
I think she would be the best to explain college admissions out of any of us.
Okay. So it's a little, it depends on like what school you applied to. So I applied to like 10 schools and 7 of them were on Common App. So like in August, there's like this website where there's like one application you can send to multiple schools. You just pay a fee for each school. But then I applied to 3 schools that weren't on Common App. So MIT has its own portal called MyMIT. And then the University of California has its own system. So I had to fill out 3 separate applications. And then on the application, you have to include like an essay, like a personal essay or a personal statement. It can be about anything, but they give you like some topics you can pick from, but you can submit any essay you want to, but basically all your jobs to show your personality. and you like should write down all your qualifications and your awards and like all your grades. Sometimes you have to manually enter them, which is really annoying, but and you put down all your scores and everything. But for some of the more selective colleges, like MIT, like you would have to do like a separate interview with an alumni. So someone within your area contacts you by email and you meet up at like a local coffee shop and you just talk for like an hour or two. And they try to get to know you and then they'll write like a little interview people. So they do that a lot. And there's also like the same thing with early and late acceptances, except there's like early action, which is non-binding. So that just means you apply early, you get your decision early. There's early decision, which is really popular these days, which is like you sign a contract. So if you get in, you definitely go to that school and you can only apply to one school early decision, but you can get deferred from early decision. So, and then of course there's regular decision, which happens, you know, in the spring. So with the early decisions, there are like three outcomes. You can be like accepted, rejected, or deferred. Deferred meaning that they move you to the regular pool. So you compete mm-hmm. against everyone else in the regular pool. And then of course they notify you of your regular decision.
It's kind of a lot.
It's really complicated.
A lot of tests. Karen, how many scores did you submit? Because I submitted like 5, maybe?
Okay, like with UC and MIT, like they kind of interrogate you. You have to write down every test you've ever taken, including math competition tests. So I had to write down my AMC, all my AP scores, every SAT I've ever taken, every ACT I've ever taken, and all my SAT subject tests. So I took like 6 subject tests. So I had to like, I had all these scores to write down and it was insane. But most schools only require like your SAT or ACT and sometimes subject tests if you're applying for a specialized major. Since I applied for CompStyle, a lot of them required one science test and then the math level 2 subject test, which are like a separate SAT thing that have nothing to do with anything, but you just have to take them anyway.
And the other thing is when you apply to individual colleges, each college has specific questions. So like, I think I wrote like almost 40 essays. Like Karen, how many did you write?
I wrote like 20 pages worth of essays. And there, it's like size 11 single spaced, like Arial font. Like it's insane. I wrote like so many essays because every school has like at least 1, if not 5 prompts. And some of them are like, just like 5 words to describe you, then explain why. It's like the most random thing. And I know I had friends that applied to like UChicago, and UChicago does this thing where they're like, you just wrote an autobiography, submit page whatever, like page 200, they'll select a random number and you have to like chronologically think about your life and then write like a page of your life down for them. But sometimes the essays are really fun, but like weird. Like USC, they like have a like a personality quiz. So they ask you like who you want your future roommate to be, your favorite TV show, theme song of your life, stuff like that to try to be fun. But it's just really random. It just depends on the school.
And like what's weird is like they ask these like fun questions, but like you're totally getting graded on it. So like you kind of have to balance like what you want like an admissions committee to see. But yeah, it's really complicated and very annoying, but it is how it is, I guess. A question from Twitch: how much does college cost in Canada, and how do you guys have scholarships?
So I know that, or at least for the programs that I know that I'll be applying for, it's about, I think it's $20,000 a year or something. And that's not including on-res or anything. And then we do have a lot of scholarships, especially through Burst Canada, that cover it. So there are a lot of opportunities for us in Canada to get scholarships and to cover that. I don't know if anyone else has any other big numbers that they know of.
I don't know much about tuition, but I know there's, like Emily mentioned, there's a lot of scholarships in Canada. A lot of, like, ones that you wouldn't have heard of, but like you have to kind of find out online and like see what they are, like the females in STEM or like computer science scholarships or just sports scholarships. There's a lot of scholarships in Canada for students, like a lot of support financially as well.
There's also like entrance scholarships. So depending on whatever grade you have when you do enter the university, they give like a certain, like they give you a scholarship based on like what grade level you're at. And yeah, I think that's
For Devin and Karen, Devin, how much is the tuition at University of Evansville? Do you know?
UE is really good at giving scholarships, but I think their average is about like $35,000 just for tuition. And then it's like an extra like $15,000 for like room and board and everything. So I've got full tuition covered, but it's still going to be like $15,000. So it's It's kind of...
The tuition is $55,000, just the tuition, and then you have to pay boarding, which is like another $15,000 to $20,000, and then you have to pay for your food and transportation, which is another $5,000. So the estimated cost of attendance is $75,000 per year.
We're also working with two different numbers. So we have Canadian dollar, which is worth $55,000, I think it's like $70,000 or way, it's way more.
It's definitely way more. And there's also like, we also have like options for boarding. So you don't have to like stay on residence, but you can have like off-campus residence, and you can stay at home too. So like, and even transportation, like for students, there's a lot of like cuts for transportation if you're a student. But finding, oh my God, $75,000 for MIT, that's crazy.
And how about the scholarships? Like, do Ivy League schools offer big scholarships?
So selective schools don't do scholarships. They do financial aid, which is all need-based. So like a lot of times, like you get very little. Well, it depends. They do, so MIT's need blind and full need. So the like the average cost of attendance is actually pretty low, because if you're at a certain income level, you get full tuition automatically. But for a majority of us, we have to like really look into outside scholarships. So I'm a national merit finalist, so I got some money that way. And I'm also like applying to a lot of scholarships online. But there's also like MIT does this thing called undergraduate research opportunities, where you can like get paid to do research or do work, or you can just get a regular job on campus. The minimum wage in Massachusetts is actually really high, so like it's kind of nice. You can make at least $5,000 a year doing that. So that's one way students try to like not drown in student loans.
Just out of curiosity, what's the minimum wage in Indiana?
$7.25.
Oh my gosh.
Is that like, do you have difference between student minimum wage and minimum wage, or?
I don't know.
So in Canada, we have student minimum wage, which I think is $12.50, and then minimum wage is $14 an hour.
And there's also like, something Karen mentioned, like you have jobs on campus, so like be paid for undergrad research opportunities. We have something similar in Canada, where like you have co-op in like the your after like your second year, you have co-op for different industry like placements you do, and then you get paid in that co-op. And sometimes what happens is like usually the co-op placements, if you do well enough in the co-op, they'll offer to pay for the rest of your tuition, or it's a conditional offering to pay for the rest of your tuition. So it's really interesting like how that works too.
It depends still, like for scholarships, like there is a lot out there that companies will do, but like for me, like I lost a lot of motivation after writing like a billion essays, so like I just didn't want to write anymore. And then the way it worked for, so I'm going to a public university, Indiana University, and you fill out like an application that applies you to all the scholarships. So I got like similar to Devin, I got free tuition. So mine will only be about $5,000 to $6,000 a year. So yay, good for me, but oh no, Karen. also, we have a ton of Twitch questions. We had a bunch of robotics questions set up, but I think these are a little bit more important. Firstly, what products are different in Canada versus the US that are you are surprised to hear about? For example, for us, like the bagged milk,
I have one.
Like out of this world. Like I had never seen anything like that. Is there anything that surprises you about?
Wait, products? You guys don't have bagged milk?
No, we have cartons only.
Yeah, we have cartons.
If you'd told us, we should have brought all our bags of milk so that we could have had them.
I have like six sometimes, on my fridge right now.
I know, I have so many. I usually come up the stairs and I hold it like a baby. I definitely have one. It's a whole thing with, I think it's like Smarties and Rockets and the other one.
Kinder eggs.
No, oh, yeah. I meant the...
Oh, yeah, Kinder is like not allowed.
Yeah, it's banned here.
Yeah. So that's, it's not like they haven't tried it, it's just like they're not allowed to try it. It's different.
But I was wondering about, I think it's like Smarties.
It's Smarties and Rockets. So like
Smarties and Rockets. Yes.
Yeah. So cause your Smarties are like what we call Rockets.
So our Smarties are, it comes in a little box and it says Smarties in really cute red.
Yeah. That's what they call it. Smarties. But like yours are giant. Like they're bigger, right?
Everything's
giant.
Do you have the candy that's like Sweet Tarts? Or isn't that the other word for Rockets?
Well, that's it. That's Rockets and Sweet Tarts are the same thing.
Anyway.
Do you have Smarties?
Yeah, we do.
Okay, but they're like sugar things.
Yeah, they come from
like
a... But, I don't
know. Those are rockets. Like little sugar, like tablets.
Yeah,
okay, yeah.
Rockets are Smarties.
So that's what we call rockets or sweet tarts.
Something else for me, I think when I... So I visit the States every so often. Kingston's only about an hour or so from New York or from the border. So something that I noticed is that in different states, you have different specialties at your McDonald's. So I remember I went to Georgia and they had peach pies and I almost cried. And I think I ate eight of them. I had eight peach pies and I was in Georgia for 2 days. And we only have, I don't know, apple and some other sad flavors, but I just thought that was really cool.
Wait,
and also the size of their huge.
Addy, I don't think there's any special McDonald's in our county, right?
No, I don't think so.
Our McDonald's are...
Yeah, no, I mean, I haven't, I don't really go, but...
We should ask you if you've tried Canadian foods, like Tim Hortons and poutine and Nanaimo bars. Have you heard of those?
Nanaimo bars are Canadian?
Yeah.
Yes, they're from BC, from Nanaimo.
Wait, and ketchup, do you have ketchup chips? Okay.
Do you have Old Dress chips?
No,
they
don't.
You all have to come to Canada.
There's a Cheetos.
And we have a thing where we get you to raise your hands if you tried something that is Canadian. Okay, how about for poutine? Have you tried poutine?
Do you know what poutine is?
It's the fries, right?
With it's fries with gravy and cheese curds. It's amazing. I can't live without it. Okay, ketchup chips.
No, I've tried it because I lived in China for three summers. So like they sell them at China in China. So that's where I eat them. Not in the U.S., in China.
Okay. All dress chips?
What are those?
Interesting.
How can
they? Oh. Okay, so all dressed.
You've not tried all dressed.
It's like so good. I can't even describe it.
Oh, Peyton has.
Oh, Peyton's tried them?
What do you think?
What are your thoughts?
I really like them. They're probably one of my favorite kinds of chips. I love them so much.
It's like kind of like a barbecue.
Yeah. I think we just buy them at like our local grocery store because my mom gets them like once every few months. really good.
I have so many questions, but there's still the people on Twitch really want to know what unique
holidays
you have.
Pardon?
Holidays?
Yeah, what unique like Canadian only holidays, because like
we have Canada Day. We have different Thanksgivings as well, because ours is in, is it November?
September.
Yes. No, ours is in
September.
Wait, our Thanksgiving's in September or October?
October.
Theirs is in November.
No, ours is,
wait, ours is in November.
What is ours in November?
Ours is in November. I know that for sure. I think it's ours is in September. No,
ours is in November.
No, October.
Ours is in November, but
Is October. I think.
Yeah, it's not.
Yeah, ours is October.
There's one that I do know about. Boxing Day. That's a thing,
yeah.
Right?
Oh yeah,
the day after Christmas.
Okay.
Like everything is on sale.
Crazy
sale. Black Friday.
It's like Black Friday, but after the leftovers.
Any other holidays? I don't know. When is like, do you guys have like a Independence Day or something? I don't know.
We have Canada Day. It's 3 days before yours.
Okay. How about, do we both do St. Patrick's Day?
Yeah. I mean, it's not a day off.
Groundhog Day.
Good Friday?
We have Groundhog. I don't know what that day is.
No one does anything for Groundhog Day.
Okay. Yeah. Like you see, the groundhog comes out in the shadow.
Wait,
do you guys know Good Friday?
Yeah, well, sometimes. Can someone from Indiana explain Groundhog Day? Because I don't know what it is.
So basically, it's like, I think it's the second day of February or something like that, where if a groundhog, like, I think it's in Pennsylvania where they do it, where if a groundhog, comes out and it sees a shadow, then they're, like, 3 more weeks of winter, or it's some special rule like that that I, like, always mix up. But otherwise, it'd be, like, only, like, 2 more weeks of winter. It's really weird.
We don't get a day off for it, though. Like, it's just...
We don't get it. It's, like, a Saturday or a Sunday, usually. Yeah.
We get, like, in February, we get, like, President's Day. We get, like, a couple days off in a row.
Oh,
February, long weekend? Ours is called Family Day Long Weekend.
No, we have
it's the same time.
Junior day that weekend.
We have lots of snow days.
Yeah.
Maybe we should go to the next question.
Yeah. Okay. What is the most popular sport in Canada versus Indiana?
Lacrosse.
Hockey and lacrosse.
No, it's lacrosse.
Hockey and lacrosse.
It's lacrosse.
It depends on where you are, though. Like in Kingston, Kingston was the original capital of Canada, and people take a lot of pride in this. We have about 125,000 students. Or people, sorry.
So the national sport of Canada is lacrosse. Hockey we are known for, but lacrosse is our national sport.
Or okay, I think more people play hockey.
Yeah, and more people play hockey, lacrosse. Yeah, but yeah. Lacrosse is the first one that came to mind.
So it's kind of like in India where their national sport is floor hockey, but everyone plays cricket.
Yeah.
Okay, I think for Indiana, I'd say either basketball or American football. Would I be correct with that?
Basketball, yeah. Probably.
Basketball, yeah.
Wait.
Basketball's popular here, but I think, at least from what I know, football isn't that popular.
No, it's not. I think rugby might even be more popular in some mm-hmm. places.
We don't have, like, huge football.
Well,
like, football's popular, but, like...
I swear I'm not trying... Like, okay, soccer or, like, American football?
American football.
Okay. We're
making sure. So, people play soccer.
Yeah, we have soccer. Soccer. Wait, so you call soccer football as well?
No. I thought maybe.
I think that's just the UK.
I was thinking that too, but I was.
That's just the UK, isn't it?
Is it the UK?
Like they call,
okay.
They call it like, soccer football.
Okay. So we have our
surgery. I would like to hear about pep rallies. Yeah. And cheerleaders.
And like those like games. Like
because Peyton lives in a college town. And that's a little bit different too. But Addie, you go to a public school. So talk about Westfield, like tailgate, homecoming.
So for our like pep rallies leading into homecoming, basically our pep rallies are known to be like pretty, they're crazy. To be honest, because a lot of weird stuff happens and people go for the laughs. But after the rally, then comes like the parade. And that, like, it's really weird because it changes each year, like the order which where we do things. So like this last year, we had a prep rally on a Friday. I think the parade was like a couple days later. Then the tailgates, we are like usually an hour before the game, and that's like just a time to like get people ready, get people pumped for like the big game. Then we have like the game is usually like a week later than the prep rally for some reason, and then like after that, then we have like the homecoming dance, or sometimes it's before. It's really weird.
Well, so Peyton, so she actually lives in the town that I'm going to college to, but so IU is like a Big Ten school. So in the Midwest, there's like 10 schools that are absolutely sports crazy and like academics crazy. So Peyton, talk a little bit about like tailgating and homecoming in Bloomington.
So homecoming is kind of to celebrate like the football team coming home from away games. And the whole week beforehand, it's essentially celebrations on campus. And then there's like a huge game. It has usually the highest attendance of any game that year, besides like maybe the Ohio State game, but that's because there's a rivalry. and it's just a time where like the college students kind of let go and they have fun because usually the football team does reasonably well, so it's just celebrating that. But my high school, we do the homecoming football games. I don't usually go to football games at my school. It's just I don't go, but there's usually like a theme for each game, and then like the week of homecoming we actually have like themes for school days. And then the Friday at the end of that week is like our school spirit day. We have the homecoming game. And then I think We have the homecoming dance either that night or the following Saturday.
There's a dance too?
Yes. We have homecoming and then we have prom.
So we have prom here, and prom for I think most schools is usually for like music banquets or arts banquets. So people are in those and they can also have, they also have their dances. But we definitely don't really have a concept of homecoming at the majority of Canadian schools.
Well, like American football is already like an American craze, but like at the high school level, like it's really important. So like my high school, they have like a chip in on their shoulder because they win like state, but like football is like such a huge thing, like, and like the letter jackets and like, or you guys have those, I don't know, but like
you don't have letter jackets.
No?
Oh. No, that's another, like, okay, you okay. Don't have those.
So like at my school, for every like activity, like really rigorous activity, you get a letter jacket, so it's kind of like your like badge of honor, I guess, I don't know.
We have hockey jerseys.
Yeah, kind of like you have your jerseys, but this is like an extra jacket. So like for our school, like all the varsity sports and like the marching band, the show choir, like the really, really intense like leaderships of some clubs will get letter jackets and badges for like winning certain things. Yeah, it is very movie like, especially my school. I think in the other Indiana kids can say, agree with me that the school that I go to is a kind of special like that.
Is it like one leather jacket that you decorate with like different pins and stuff that you collect from different teams that you're part of, or do you get like multiple jackets?
You get jacket per activity, but so like our marching band, because they're like grand national like people, so for every competition they win that year, they get like an extra strip or bar on their jacket, and it's like
so cool.
That's so cool. I thought like this was only movies.
I don't know. Do you guys have lockers? Like, is that a thing?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
Lockers. Good. Because apparently some schools don't have lockers, and I was like, oh no.
Lockers don't have locks on them.
What?
We have like a trusting policy where like we trust everyone not to steal things or whatever because we're such a small school, and it's also just like easier because your lockers won't get stuck anymore, so there's no locks.
I know a lot of elementary schools don't have lockers. Like my elementary school has lockers, but bunch of them don't.
But they don't have anything to keep safe. Like what, like the jacket? What is it?
We had like locker. Like my elementary school when I was in grade 3 was built like brand new. So we had lockers that were like twice the size of a normal locker. And so when you're in younger grades, you'd share it with someone else. And then when you were in grade 7 and 8, you got your own huge locker. And then once you got to high school, you got half the size of that.
I have seen the lockers at Emily's school, and like the lockers at Emily's school are big. They're bigger than the lockers at my school.
Wait, at my high school?
Yeah, your high school.
And okay, like, well then it's like triple.
My school has a swimming pool.
It has a swimming pool community center connected to it. So in grade 9 when we did gym and such, we had part of it we had to do swimming. Which I was not a big fan of.
Gym that's split into 3 sessions, like.
Yeah. So we had a certain number of lessons or we had to do it in the pool, depending whether it worked with your class. So my class was like first period in grade 9, so we got to go in the pool. And yeah.
We should probably move on to the next question. Yeah.
Sorry.
Actually, we are probably going to have to wrap up as the next session is going to start at 6:30. And we didn't even get to talk about robotics, which is what I'd planned to talk about. But this is still a good time. We talked about, this was very eye-opening for all of us, and I think for our viewers as well. This was super fun, but one last thing, if we can do super, super fast, if everyone could say like how they've been passing time during quarantine, just to like relax and like have fun or doing something positive, just we'll go rapid fire. Just someone start and then we'll finish up after that.
I've been doing lots of homework and playing video games on the side.
Yeah, I've been doing
the next person's name.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh no, patient should go though.
I've been doing homework and then just playing a lot of video games. I finished like 2 games in 1 week, Namira.
I've been volunteering a lot, and I've also been watching Tiger King, if anyone knows it. Karen?
I've been doing a lot of, like, reading and homework and watching some TV shows.
Name.
I've been doing a lot of bullet journaling, and I'm playing songs on the guitar.
Hey, Sean?
Yeah, for sure. I'm just trying to learn some new skills. I recently got some audio software, so I'm trying to make some music.
Addy?
I'm a hacker, yeah, sure. Oh, okay.
I've been reading a lot and watching a lot of YouTube, like vlogs and stuff. Amiko?
I've also
been- I'm studying for my AP exams, but I'm learning how to play my ukulele. I've been cooking. It's crazy. Huda?
Okay, I've been doing a lot of homework. I made a personal goal to like try to watch every single thing on Netflix. So far, there's a lot of stuff. There's so much stuff. You won't believe how much stuff there is on Netflix. Tiger King is next on my list, though. And I believe, did everyone go?
Amiko?
Priya. Amiko.
Priya.
Well, I've also been reading a lot, like Addy. Our school's kind of going hard with the e-learning for absolutely no reason. Like, everyone's kind of done with it, but I have a lot of homework. I'm doing some reading. We got a Netflix, so that's been fun. But I just wanted to say thank you to everyone who came today. This was super fun. We definitely need to do a part two because we didn't get to talk about robotics at all, or all the candy that we haven't tried and you have tried. And someone needs to bring their letter jacket to a call. So,
and next time we'll bring all of our old dress and milk. Ketchup chips.
Milk.
Our milk bags.
And our milk bags.
Our bags of milk.
Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful
day. Yeah, so in 2021 in Detroit, we want to see all the stuff. Canadian teams, you bring all the stuff. And then
we'll bring all of our.
We need a trade.
Yeah, and we'll get make sure all the Indiana teams wear their letter jackets.
We'll trade.
Yeah. We didn't even.
The letter over the border.
We didn't even talk about how large our basketball gymnasiums are in our high schools in Indiana. So,
Priya knows.
We're home to 17 of the largest basketball gymnasiums in the United States in our high schools. Our state championship for first here in Indiana is in a gymnasium that seats about 10,000 people. That's a high school basketball gym. So most of our gyms are a lot bigger than the schools that they're a part of, but everybody watches basketball. So thank you so much. And this is just part of the Canadian Youth Council for First Canada. There are 16 members on the council. And that's the other thing we didn't really even get to too, that a part two I think would be great is to talk a little bit about some of the projects that you all have been doing while you're on the council. And how we'd had an earlier conversation about maybe next year, our first Indiana student board and you all, the Canadian Youth Council, working together on some of those. So thank you so much for your time. We're gonna move on to our last session of the evening. I'm sure Priya, Emily, and a few of you can talk about a part two and maybe talk about robots, but this was great. So thank you so much for your time. And we're gonna bring Kathie on now, who's been a part of FIRST for a long time. And Kathy's going to talk about, yes, there is an I in team, and talking about how you integrate introverts into your FIRST robotics team. Kathie, thank you for joining us. And what a fantastic conversation that we just heard.
It was a lot of fun.
It was. And I think while there's some differences, I saw a lot of similarities. I heard a lot of similarities, a lot of homework kind of stress and academics and things like that. But another great thing that I heard was from all of them, that the joy of being in FIRST, that joy of community. And this is an example of that community that FIRST is so great.
Thank you, Chris. To expand on that, my husband and I have often said that we would never have all of the friends around the world that we have had it not been for FIRST. So it works for the adults as well as the students. I'm going to share my screen here. Hopefully, share my screen. Let's see if I can get it to come up. Sorry about that. And I seem to be having some problems, but bear with me here for a moment. It worked earlier. That's
all right. Yeah, we had it going earlier. We can get it going.
We did. Let me try that again. All right, I will try this again and see. There we go. Well, I think we can get it now.
There we go.
And hey, I think we're sort of getting there. I apologize. I am having some problems with my network today. It keeps dropping me. So hopefully we can get through all of this. I'm trying to get back to our first screen here. And there we go. All right. So yes, this is a presentation that I originally prepared for the first World Conference way back in 2013. But since then, lots of people have contacted me to talk about introverts and extroverts. So every successful team includes extroverts and introverts. And I know that it can be really tricky to get your introverts comfortable with working within a team environment. It's not natural to us. I am a strong introvert myself. And then also teaching your extroverts how to work with the introverts who are not exactly like them personality-wise. So this session, I'm going to offer you tips and suggestions for getting the most out of your valuable introvert team members. I'll talk a little bit about icebreakers, brainstorming, and attending competitions. So this presentation was originally written for FRC teams in mind, but much of the information is applicable to all first teams. Don't apply, but I'm confident that we'll get back to our regular routine. So I'm happy to share these ideas with you today. So a little bit about introverts versus extroverts. An introvert, it's not about us being shy. We're not always necessarily shy. I used to be shy when I was younger. I'm still a little bit shy, but it's not about that. An extrovert could actually be shy. It's not about wanting to be alone or being antisocial, but it is about how we draw our energy and recharge our batteries. So extroverts draw their energy from being around people and activities. Introverts recharge our batteries by being alone and thinking about things. This affects both adults and students on the team, but the adults might have learned coping mechanisms. For example, I often hear from people that know me through FIRST that you can't be an introvert. You sound like an extrovert. Well, it's only because I've learned some of those skill sets that I need in order to talk to people and talk in front of people as an adult, especially. It's something that I have learned. It's a learned behavior, but my innate personality is definitely a strong introvert. It's not about us versus them, introverts versus extroverts. It's about using our inherent strengths and weaknesses for the team's best interest. If we, the introverts, take time to be alone, don't misinterpret it as us not wanting to be a team player. We just need to recharge. Here's a quote that I had found when I was doing research. Introverts are people who find other people tiring. Extroverts are energized by people and will fade or wilt when alone. They often seem bored by themselves in both senses of the expression. Leave an extrovert alone for 2 minutes and he'll reach for his cell phone. In contrast, after an hour or two of being socially on, we introverts need to turn off and recharge. Extroverts can rally troops around an idea. They're natural cheerleaders. They come up with solutions to a problem by talking it through. Introverts gather facts and may come back and counter those ideas that the group has previously accepted. by saying things like, yes, but they may be perceived negatively as pessimists, which will be bewildering to the introvert who's simply doing what comes naturally to them. Extroverts should remember that sometimes it pays to be quiet and listen to others, and introverts should remember to speak up and justify their thoughts during the problem-solving phase. Let's see if we can get back here. We kind of got ahead of ourselves a little bit on the slides. One parent of an introvert said to me, try to remember that there are many ways to be successful. Someone does not have to be like you in order to be smart or a helpful, useful, productive part of the team. Remember to include the introverts by celebrating their abilities rather than forcing them to be remade in the image of an outgoing student is a big point that I feel needs to be made. And her son said to me, you're better off having an extroverted leader in charge of an introverted group and an introverted leader in charge of an extroverted group. The premise is that in both examples, exactly one party is taking the creative initiative. An extrovert can more easily manage a group of compartmentalized introverts, and an introvert can mastermind for a group of extroverts as they do their weird hive mind cooperation thing. Continuing on that, let's see. With their endless appetite for talk and attention, extroverts also dominate the social life. So they tend to set expectations. In our extroverted society, being outgoing is considered normal and therefore desirable, a mark of happiness, confidence, and leadership. Extroverts are seen as big-hearted, vibrant, warm, empathic. A people person is a compliment, whereas introverts are described with words like guarded, loner, reserved, taciturn, self-contained, and private. They're narrow, ungenerous words, words that suggest emotional parsimony and smallness of personality. I think this is true, although I see in recent years that things are beginning to change, especially with the research or the TED Talks and the books by people like Susan Cain. If you have not read Susan Cain or listened to her TED Talk, I recommend that you do. It really give you some really great ideas. Extroverts like to experience a lot, and introverts like to know a lot about what they experience. Extroverts like breadth, introverts like depth. Introverts dislike interruptions because it takes an idea or a project. Introverts' brains go into overdrive to process the thoughts. And as a result, our anxiety levels increase a notch. They're processing your idea. This is something that I find myself doing a lot, yawning when someone is talking to me, and I feel bad about it, but it's something that I can't control. It's an automatic response as my body is trying to process what you're saying to me. Also, we'll often break eye contact and look around as we gather our thoughts to reply in conversation. So I do that a lot. And you may find as you're talking with people in robotics that they do the same. They'll look off to the side as they're trying to come up with the words that they're trying to say. And that's because we have a longer pathway to retrieve vocabulary than our extroverted counterparts. So we often will say things like, what's the word I'm thinking of? What am I looking for? It's not that we're having problems processing, it's just the way our brains are wired. Introverts may drive you crazy asking for details. We need to do our research in order to perform well. I am an extreme detail person, and I drove our lead mentor on my robotics team, 173. I drove him crazy. I was constantly asking for details because I want all the details. It's not because I want to be in control of anything. It's just that it helps me to know what everything is about so I can process my little part in whatever project I'm working on. In the workplace, note that if your team meets like this, a big meeting followed by working independently, the introverts may resent the fact that the extroverts always seem to have someone in their office. They always seem to be engaged in casual conversations. The introverts may think the extroverts are slackers not getting their work done, when in fact the extroverts are working. They're gathering facts and re-energizing through these social interactions. The extroverts are the ones gathered at the water cooler while the introverts just want to get a drink and get back to their desk. The extroverts, through the social interactivity, are gathering information about your organization. They're usually the ones in touch with who is leaving the company, who is getting promoted, what projects are coming up, etc. Things that the introverts might not have a clue about because our networking skills are not honed. On a robotics team, the extroverts may be organizing events with other teams' members. They may know what strategies the other teams are planning to use, what their robots look like, who's dating whom, whose team mentor is retiring. They have the pulse of the organization. And oftentimes, introverts who are not into all of that socialization may be criticized as being clueless. And this is not true at all. It's just that we're not out there talking with everyone, getting all that information. So it's really important that the extroverts learn how to share that with everyone when it's appropriate. So we have a lot of strengths that can be really used well before we speak or act. We write well. We like to work independently. We build deep, lasting relationships. We may only have one or two or three close friends, but they are close friends versus an extrovert who may know everyone on the team. We listen attentively. We like to do research, which is great if you are in a program and first where you need to do the research projects. Another strength of ours is concentrating, gaining expertise because we like to do the research. We have the high attention to details. We're good at planning and organizing, and we're able to meet deadlines. So, because you now know what some of the introvert strengths are, I think that can help you, especially if you're a mentor or student leader on your team, to use those skill sets when you're assigning different projects or tasks to your students on the team. Icebreakers. So usually every robotics team starts out with their season with some kind of an icebreaker where you get to learn everybody else's names and maybe a few facts about each other. This round robin style of introductions could put the introvert on the spot. They might be reluctant to share personal information or be the focus of attention. I hate being the focus of attention. Instead, consider asking team members to share team-related information. For example, what is your role on the team if you're a veteran member? Or if you're a rookie member, what might you be interested in doing on the team? Oftentimes, rookie members are clueless in that they have no idea what roles are available to them on the team. So that question might not work, but it certainly is something you could ask. For example, what do you like to do when you get home from school, let's say, and then help to translate. Introverts don't like name tags because it focuses attention to them. They might wish to remain anonymous. Extroverts are usually out there meeting everyone anyway, so they don't need name tags. Announce that you're going to hold an icebreaker or a team building meeting in advance and encourage people to write down or think about one or two things you'd like other people on the team to know about you. The team leader can gather these and read them aloud or give the option to announce yourself. Alternately, have team members interview each other, maybe working one-on-one, to learn these facts and then relay them to the team. And if time permits, suggest that they can pair up with additional people, which will please your extroverts. Brainstorming, which is one of my favorite parts of the season in FIRST. So when your group is brainstorming, while we're doing brainstorming activities, such as we use post kickoff, those are great for extroverts. The introverts might appreciate the time to absorb it all, read the game manual, think about strategies before communicating them to the team. So you might want to spend the rest of your kickoff Saturday doing kit inventory or some other activity, and then get together the next day for brainstorming. This allows your introverts the time they need to do the research they need in order to be an effective member of the team during the brainstorming session. Consider breaking into small groups to discuss different parts of the game challenge. For example, defensive or offensive strategies, different ways to score, what kinds of robot designs would be needed by each. By splitting them into the team members into smaller groups, this is adults and students, it allows your introverts to become more relaxed and more engaged in the brainstorming process. Assign robot design brainstorming tasks to pairs. If we decided to be a defensive robot, what would the robot need to do? If we want to climb, what would the robot need? If we want to shoot balls, what would the shooter look like? Those kinds of things. Team building. In my many years in FIRST, I've done many team building sessions, but I have to admit, when I first started out as a mentor on our team, I did not want to go to our team building weekend. I thought it was a ridiculous waste of my time. I did not want to be there the whole weekend. And as it turned out, we had a blast. So that's something to consider if you have the opportunity, is to hold an actual team building weekend. Even your introverts, if you do it correctly, will have a good time. So one of the things you need to be aware of here in the US is our culture, which encourages what we call groupthink, or working together as a team. It does not necessarily promote innovation. There is value to independent research and study. Just make sure that we're sharing those results with the main group. One of the things you can do is, when you split off into your smaller subgroups, is have a weekly meeting where each subgroup then relays what they've been working on to the main group, so everyone is informed. The new groupthink elevates teamwork above all else. It insists that creativity and intellectual achievement come from a gregarious place, and that's just simply not true. Educate the team about personality styles so that everyone understands the other members on the team. There is no right or wrong, it's just different preferences. If you can do a Myers-Briggs test or some other personality test, I believe that was discussed a few weeks ago on one of the Finn calls, try and do that with your team members if at all possible. Or a simple thing that you can do during a team building exercise is what I call the continuum line. This is where the whole team stands in a straight line, let's say, and at one end of the line is the extreme that you are an extrovert, and at the other end of the line is the extreme for the introverts. And somewhere in the middle is where most people will end up. But you just say certain statements like, I prefer to work on my own, or other statements like that you can find online. Most of my team building sessions, the games and things that I played, I did find on the internet. So there's a lot out there to look for. Look for the continuum line. And team members will then gravitate towards one end of the line or the other, or somewhere in the middle. And by watching everyone on your team, you'll kind of get to know where their strengths lie or what their perceived strengths are. And that will help you a lot when you go to decide who's going to be working on what projects. Mix your team building activities, provide some large groups, some small group, pairs, independent activities if you can, and then some physical group activities. Split the team into sub-teams, provide a team building challenge which combines many mini challenges. So some are social group or physical activities, and others are focused puzzles, brain teasers. This will appeal. And creating training sessions for your team allow for both hands-on collaborative learning for your extroverts, as well as one-on-one training for your introverts. This is really important. You will learn better if you are being trained in the style that you your personality fits into. Offer written questions as a review of the training. Introverts will reflect on what they've learned and then go over the answers at the next meeting, which will make the extroverts happy. Present one idea or a project at a time, or multiple ideas followed up in writing. Your introverts will be processing the first one, as you may be announcing the second or third ones and may not be able to keep up. Meetings. Please, 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 whenever possible, present an agenda in advance of a meeting to allow the introverts time to think about the issues or the problems and come up with potential solutions, suggestions, or ideas on their own. Establish meeting ground rules, no interruptions, respect each other's thoughts. Consider having a public comment period after a meeting, but before a final decision about a problem is made, and allow the introverts to share our ideas in writing after a meeting. We might not feel comfortable to say something at the meeting, but then later on that evening, we might say, oh, you know what, let's do it this way. I'm gonna make this suggestion, send it in writing, and then allow that decision to be made later. Likewise, don't put us on the spot in a meeting. If you meet with us individually prior to the meeting to present an idea or a problem, we'll be able to respond to it when you call on us at the meeting. Facilitate the meeting so that everyone has the opportunity to speak. This should be standard at all meetings anyway. But recognize that just as all ideas are welcome during the brainstorming process, and all ideas are welcome from both the introverts and the extroverts, and that the naturally verbal extrovert behavior may sway a group into a decision that might not be the best for them. As the project leader, observe both verbal and nonverbal cues when facilitating project discussion. This is hard to do unless you're doing a virtual meeting or a meeting in person. But even an inflection of tone of voice can make a difference. Okay, introvert assignments. These are some things that we're good at doing. Consider in asking an introvert student to research a topic, then mentor another student or a small group. Ask the introvert student to be the judge for your team's presenters, for example, chairman's award or your team's elevator speech, so that those people can practice. They may excel at scouting, website, not necessarily at other social media forums, archiving, or be the team historian, the rules person on the team, so they're always up to date with all the rules changes, CAD, programming, writing a blog or a newsletter, writing to your sponsors, being the project manager, maybe not the person in charge, but in charge of reminding everyone else about meeting deadlines, and travel planning. Those are great things that we're good at. If you're going to break into groups to work on a problem, make the groups small. Make sure they're functioning like the larger group and that everyone is encouraged to have input. Ask what the team members want to do. They may naturally gravitate to tasks suited to their personality type. Who are your spokespersons? Probably your extroverts. But your introverts may have some really good suggestions about your elevator speech or how to market your team. They might not feel comfortable presenting that message to others, though. Ask your introverts to mentor new students on the team. Ask your introverts to speak to the judges. We might think the extroverts would be good at that, but the introverts' love of ideas and images make us good candidates to tell the team's story to the judges. Mentors and chaperones, you might prefer morning duty when the team travels because you might be a morning person, but also because you need time alone by yourself at the end of the day to recharge. So I am better suited to getting everyone up and ready in the morning instead of bed checks at the end of the day. And assign a private project journaling exercise. Keeping a journal allows team members to write down ideas, explore impacts and consequences of these ideas, be creative in a non-threatening atmosphere. Encourage participants to use this tool to brainstorm ideas and organize their thoughts before a meeting. Consider the use of an engineering journal for your team's journey during the season, like we do in FTC. Communications. So extroverts may prefer extroverts might prefer in-person or video conferencing. There we go. Introverts might prefer emails, text messages, or an online forum. Introverts might take their time before responding when in a conversation with you, so just keep that in mind. enable small groups or one-on-one conversations to occur, and we may not speak often, but our thoughts count. Please listen. Travel. So if your team is fortunate enough to travel to an event, that presents some more problems, potential problems. Sharing hotel rooms, try to group the extroverts together and the introverts together. If it's a mixed group, there will always be conflict because the introverts don't get any free time to recharge their batteries. Try to establish a quiet room where introverts can gather at the end of the day, maybe to read or to listen to music with earphones on. Let the extroverts have their social time in a different room. Allow for some downtime during the day if possible. Going from one group activity like the competition to another, perhaps mealtime, would be very tiring and stressful on introverts. If the hotel is within walking distance from the venue, allow a mentor to bring a group back to the hotel for a while before meeting up again for dinner, for example. Introverts may be experiencing sensory overload. Extroverts need varied activities with lots of people to interact with. Taking a group of students to the mall might work for them versus going to a movie or maybe a small game challenge in the hotel, which might work for your introverts. And poll your team members in advance to see what they like to do at the end of the busy competition day. This might help plan your evening activities. So, thoughts for today. This is a new slide I just added because we are in a different time. Keep in touch with your team, students, and mentors alike, perhaps via social or platforms like Zoom. Don't assume that the introverts are okay with no social activity. And remember that introverts may be struggling with finding the alone time they crave when the whole family surrounds them all day long. And the extroverts may be feeling especially lonely without their usual social interactions. Like with any meeting, send out an agenda ahead of time, even if it's just to check in and see how everyone is doing. Include a question that everyone can be thinking about before the meeting. Take a virtual attendance and follow up individually for those members who didn't attend, just to check in with them. Encourage team members to schedule Google Hangout game nights or Netflix movie watch parties. Activities like these benefit both extroverts and introverts. Enable in-person meetings following social distancing guidelines if your location allows it. Organize a car hangout where everyone stays in their cars but gets to see each other physically. If you're on an FLL Junior, FLL, or FTC team, look for ways to engage your team in robot challenges virtually. This is a little harder to do with FRC teams, but you might be able to dig up video recordings from years past and review them together as a learning activity. And do wellness checks. For many of us, FIRST is a huge part of our life. It's a place where being weird is accepted. It's a safe zone. For some, it's the only place where we can feel accepted for who we are. Something I encourage mentors to do every year, if you have high school seniors on your team, check in with them. They may be realizing that their first student career is over. They may be wondering what school looks like for the rest of the year or how their family is going to pay bills and buy food. Or they might be worried about the next step in their lives, college, joining the military, et cetera. Many people are depressed, anxious, and worried right now, and be sure to offer support or point them to appropriate resources. And so if you've got any questions, I know I kind of went through this quickly tonight, but my email address is kentfieldk@gmail.com. And I'll just leave you with this last slide, which is by William Wordsworth when talking about introvert Albert Einstein. And thank you.
Well, Kathie, thank you very much. We appreciate your time and the presentation to go through all that. And I'll have you send that to me. We'll get that up onto our Finn website. People Great. Can go ahead and take another look at that. And I just want to remind everybody, as we kind of wind down this evening, thank you for all those who watched. Thank you for all the people who participated to help bring this great content to us this evening. Tomorrow, we've got a lot more content for you. As I had mentioned earlier, we've got a conversation about teamwork. We're going to kick off with an interview with Nick Lawrence, who is with Animark. On resource tokens, a way for teams to kind of manage their resources. And that'll be a great conversation. So hopefully you'll tune in tomorrow, 4 p.m. to 7 p.m. And thank you so much to everyone who attended and participated tonight. Have a great evening. Thank you so much.